Well, good morning, everybody. How's it going? Let me try that again. Good morning, everybody. Oh, it's good to be in the house of the Lord. My name is John. I serve as one of the pastors here, and I get to have the opportunity of serving at all of our different campuses and our ministries, and it's a joy to be here today. We get to worship the Lord together, and we get to lift high His name, and that is an exciting opportunity that we have. And if this is your first time to Harvest, or you're relatively new to Harvest, I'd love to have a chance to meet you afterward. We have a class that's called Discover Harvest. It's a quick welcome, get to know some of the staff, hear a little bit about the church. It's taking place in our Hope Center right after the service. I'd love to invite you to be a part of that and get to know you in that brief way. And if you're a regular part of Harvest, I would encourage you to take out your phones and to check in. The reason why we do that is we want to know that you're here, but we also want to know how it is that we can pray for you this week. If you're looking for a way to get connected, like what's my next step, all inside that app, there's an opportunity for you to find community groups and D groups and all sorts of things in there. And if you're like, what is he talking about? You can scan the QR code on the chair near you and it'll take you right to that app. Well, Harvest over this last year had an apprentice program. And the reason why we had an apprentice program is because we're a church that's trying to raise people up and send people out. And this apprentice program is a gap year program. It's for those who are like just finished high school, or maybe they finished a year of college and they're like, Lord, what is it that you would have for me in my life? How have you designed me and where can I serve you? And so we had some students be a part of it this year. And I want you to think about who might be a good candidate to be a part of next year's program. So to learn more about this, why don't you look at the screen?
The apprenticeship program is a 9-month program for young adults. Young adult age group is a really important transitional time of life where you're making decisions, you're figuring out lots of things. And so we want to take 9 months and really invest in young adults, give them opportunity to serve in the church. So 3 things, serving the local church in ministry, being paid for that, take some classes through Moody Bible Institute, getting a biblical foundation, tying that all together as a cohort and grow together through the process.
The program is set up so that the apprentices experience 20 hours of ministry training and study and 20 hours of actually serving in a ministry context. They were able to engage a wide range of areas of need and care across our campuses.
These last 9 months have been absolutely incredible. I was working with Harvest students and I got to be a part of their meetings and planning events and just talking about the direction of where this ministry is going. Seeing all the behind the scenes that happens has been really fun.
The most memorable thing from the program was being able to serve in the preschool room every Sunday. I was able to form relationships with so many of the kids and be able to see them so regularly.
You have to be very disciplined on the academic side of it, but also some of the main challenges that I feel like they face have been like the challenges that a lot of us in ministry have experienced.
I just felt the weight of ministry, of leading people. God saw me as trustworthy to lead His people, where I didn't think I was qualified at all, and I was scared. And it taught me how to be extroverted, where I'm not usually extroverted, and I learned that it has nothing to do with me, and it has all to do with Him. And I think that in that, I've learned so much.
Before I believed in Jesus, I like didn't care about anything. So for me to spend time with students about their beliefs and even something like doing games, like talking in front of a large group of people was off, like really foreign to me. Of the nature of the program, I like had to do those things. It's been really cool. I can see how God has made me more comfortable in those things.
It's something really valuable to be able to see the inside of the church, to have the experience with Moody, being able to learn about theology and just be in a group of like-minded young adults.
Step into something that might not be your comfort or might not be something you imagined yourself doing, but trust that God's gonna provide financially, He's gonna provide spiritually and physically in whatever way that you need.
One of the best parts about it is all of the people that you'll be around, whether they're pastors or not. There's so much wisdom and encouragement to be around the church and God's people and people who work in ministry.
Seeing what it means to be a body of Christ and how we've all come together and how we all need each other, I have so much of an appreciation, and just seeing all the behind the scenes that it takes to run ministry. I can't say enough good things about it. It's truly been one of the hardest 9 months, but also the best 9 months that I've experienced.
Well, you You can learn more about this program at harvestbible.org/apprenticeship. And we also have a brochure in the lobby by the Harvest Connect counter. And if you know of someone that would be an encouragement, a blessing, helping them find their way, please let us know how we might be able to serve them. Well, this week is an exciting week here at this campus. High Five. Setup begins today. How many of you are part of High Five? Yeah. God is going to use this week in a really powerful way. I was at the Elgin campus on Friday, and I was talking to one of the moms there, and she was like, we invited somebody to come to High Five, and by the end of the week, after hearing the gospel a couple different times, she gave her life to Christ, and now she is a part of the family of God. And would you join us as a church in praying for the kids that are going to be coming to High Five this week? They're going to have fun, guarantee it. They're going to have food, and they're going to meet some other people, but we really want them to know that life is all about Jesus. And so could we take a moment just to pray for this week, for our leaders, for the kids that are going to be coming, and let's do that right now. Lord, we are thankful that we have a church that wants to be bold in its proclamation of who you are and that you offer salvation. You offer this gift freely to all. And so this week we pray for our leaders who are investing into the lives of these children, to the next generation. We pray that as they open your word, as they love upon these kids, that they would understand that you love them and you have a gift that you want to give to them, and it's salvation. So Lord, use this week in a powerful way, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, why don't we stand to our feet? Let's worship the Lord in spirit and truth.
Oh, come on, church. I came expecting to meet with him today. Come put those hands together as we sing.
I'll praise in the valley. I'll praise on the mountain.
That's right.
I'll praise when I'm sure. Oh, praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when outnumbered. Oh, praise when surrounded. As praises the waters, my enemies drowning.
We sing this out together as long.
As long as I'm breathing. Oh, I've got a reason to praise.
Oh, praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Come on, let's celebrate together.
Oh, praise.
church, let's give him praise today.
Thank you for your goodness.
There's a song within me, reaching from the inside out. Forever in the making, you're composing even now. I've heard it in the heavens, angels circling round and round. No end and no beginning, I lift my voice to join their song. Join their song. Praise God, the name above all names. Praise God, the Holy One who reigns. Praise God, the heavens cry out night and day. Through and fields of riches, or true even on burying.
Such a great opportunity for us to extol the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords by praising his name. We get to worship him each week as we gather here. We worship him throughout the week individually. We get to worship the Lord in several different ways. And one of the ways that we do right now is we worship the Lord through our giving. And in Luke chapter 12, verse 34, it says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." You know, Lord cares mostly about our heart condition and the posture and the way that we give. And so it's just like when you are walking downtown or you're getting in a race or you're riding a bike and you have a heart monitor strapped to you and you're trying to determine, is my heart in the right place so that I can continue on? The Lord wants our heart posture to be something that is mindful of where he is at work, and that we would be a generous people and give in those ways and in those places. And I'm thankful that we have a church that's really trying to further the Lord's kingdom. And so there's many ways that we have listed on the screen for us to give to the Lord's work here at our church, that he would use this place as a vehicle to further his gospel. And maybe you aren't going to be giving today your expression of worship to him, but you're going to be doing it through the week. Remember this verse, that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And so I just want to pray over the offerings that are being given. And can we do that right now? Father, you are a good and perfect God. You are the one and true God. You are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. You are holy and just and worthy of our praise. And we have just taken some time to sing that to you. Praise God. And Lord, as we worship you through our giving, would you find our hearts in a place of readiness? Would you find our hearts in a place of joy? Would you help us to be excited about giving to your work, Lord? And these funds that come in, Lord, we don't take that lightly. We want them to be used in the greatest way to further your gospel. And so, Lord, we give these to you because we love you. And we're thankful for the way that you provide for us. Take these expressions and use them greatly. In Jesus' name, amen.
There is a kingdom here and yet to come. God of creation came to dwell. What a Savior, what a friend. Jesus, you triumph over the curse of sin and death. You rescue the helpless, and you call us citizens. So we join the saints in worship to our God. Most worthy, hallelujah to the King of glory. You reign forevermore. Yes. All of the nations will bow before your throne, all of your children. We'll lift up heaven's song, singing holy, holy, holy is our God. We offer all we are in worship to you, God. Oh, hallelujah to the one most worthy. Hallelujah to the King of glory. Every breath I worship. worship you, God. In life or death, the victory's won. For who you are and all that you've done, all the praise is yours. Yes, it is.
We sing that again with every breath.
With every breath, I'll worship you, God.
Our praise. You're worthy of our lives. You're worthy of our song. And we join with the song of heaven declaring, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And we thank you for who you are and all that you've done. You deserve all the praise. You deserve all the glory. All the power belongs to you. We thank you for your presence here in this place. In Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, can we give him praise to the God who's most worthy of our praise? Amen. Amen. Hey, we're going to continue our service, but before we do, junior hires, you're dismissed. Everyone else, why don't you say hi to someone around you?
Good morning, Harvest. How are you doing today? My name is Romarez Moody. I serve as the campus pastor here at our Rolling Meadows campus, and I am excited to open up God's Word with you. It's an honor and a privilege to do that with you. So if you could grab your Bibles and head on over to 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, as we continue in our series this morning. When legendary coach Newt Rockne was the head football coach at Notre Dame, a column appeared in the school newspaper with no clue on who wrote it other than the signature line of Old Bearskin. The column was highly critical of the football players, and the author seemed to have some intricate details about each and every player's strengths and weaknesses. And he spared no words in the column, lambasting each player for the shortcomings and inept performances each week on the field. So when the players complained to Rockne about the stark criticism that they received, he sympathized with them. And he encouraged them to get back out there and give it another go. Try again. The writer of the column was never identified until, guess what? When Rockne passed away, the columns ceased all of a sudden. So it was clear that the player's friend and mentor and coach was the author of these articles. Newt was a great football player himself, and he was well aware of the successes that could come in football and how one's head can be a little larger than it should be. And so, in a way, Newt was trying to help his players stay humble and to avoid the pitfalls of pride. Pride is a pitfall, and Coach Newt knew this well. But it's amazing to see how sometimes the Lord will use other people to humble us. When the Lord allows someone to cut us down to size, we should thank him for it because he cares about us. He wants us to be humble recipients of his grace, and God uses the critics in our lives to help us to become more humble. When you think you've arrived, you have a long ways to go. Pride is something that could creep in. It's a trap. And it's a trap that not only Coach Newt Rockne knew well, but Peter knew well also. You remember Peter so famously told Jesus in Matthew chapter 26, verse 33, Jesus was speaking to the disciples and he said, "You will all fall away from me." And Peter aggressively said, "No, these guys might fall away, but Lord, I will never fall away. In fact, I will never deny you." And of course, he did. But there was a picture of his pride. Pride is a hidden and unexpected danger. It's a trap. It's unnoticeable. It's easy to fall into sometimes. It's a pitfall. And so today in the text, Peter will show us how to navigate pride in a humble way. Thus, the title to today's message is Pitfalls. And so what we're going to see in the text in verses 1 through 5 is first a charge for leaders, a challenge for the young, and a call for everyone. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word and how you use it to show us how to live a Christian life. And so, Lord, it is our prayer this morning that you allow the word spoken today to penetrate the hearts of your people. Lord, would you also open up hearts to receive what you have for us today? We thank you and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. The first point for today is charge to leaders, and we see that in verses 1 through 4, and this is what it says. This is Peter speaking. "So I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder and a witness to the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. Shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory." So we've been in the book of 1 Peter for some time, and we learned as Christians, how to suffer in persecution. when it's not caused by you, in most cases. But in this chapter 5, Peter starts out by addressing elders and how they should lead the flock in a humble way as not to fall into the pitfall of pride. And so the concept of elders is throughout the Bible, starting in the Old Testament with Moses. As you could remember, Moses was settling the affairs of the church, and it took him the whole day. So from dusk to dawn, he's trying to resolve disputes amongst the people of Israel. And so the Lord came to him in Numbers 11, and he said, Moses, grab 7 mature men in the community. 70, I'm sorry, mature men into the community, and the same spirit that I have laid on you, I will lay on them. So the idea of older men and being overseers, those who are mature in faith and are called to govern the church and to guide the affairs of the church and to teach, was established in the Old Testament and then continue to the New Testament. If you remember, as Paul planted churches throughout each city, he would appoint elders. There'd be elders at the gates. There'll be elders in heaven. We learn that in Revelation chapter 5, where John writes that around the throne of God are 24 lesser thrones in which the elders will sit upon. And we'll learn who those people are when we make it to heaven. And so Paul is exhorting the elders here in the text. And he says, I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder. And this is a posture of humility here with Peter. Like, obviously, he has a little bit more experience, hands-on experience, right? He was walking with Jesus, and he learned firsthand from him. But he addresses the elders as a fellow elder. That is a picture of humility. And it seems that he's grown in that. And I pray that that is true for us as well. But notice he also says he's a witness of the sufferings of Christ. When Jesus was arrested, Peter followed along as they led Jesus into the court of Caiaphas. And along the way, he was spat upon and mocked and called hail to the King of the Jews in a mockingly way. And Peter witnessed that, and he followed along all the way through to the crucifixion. So Peter said, he's saying here, I am a witness. I am an eyeball witness. And witness here is not describing a spectator. It's someone who could give testimony to what he has seen. This thought of a Messiah suffering was at one time distasteful to Peter. Look at this interaction in Matthew chapter 16, 21 through 23. Jesus and Peter here. It says, from the time Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem to suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes. Now, of course, here, these are not the elders in the church. These are the elders in the synagogue. They did not participate in the crucifixion, but they did not do anything to stop it. We'll just say that. And to be killed, and on the third day, be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke Jesus, saying to him, far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, Jesus did, get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me. Jesus rebuked him because he immediately recognized that the enemy was using Peter to be an obstacle to the gospel, to God's plan and purpose for all of us. But this is a glimpse of where Peter was at the time. Peter was like, okay, that might be the plan, Lord, but I have a better plan. In fact, I can stop this. You don't have to suffer. I'm sure many of us have had those moments to where we try to control everything in our lives, including suffering, instead of surrendering to the Lord like Christ did. Peter's pride got in the way here. We know that Peter did see this come to pass. He did see Jesus suffer. And it's now his task to bear witness to the reality and the significance of it, which he has done repeatedly throughout this epistle. Paul also witnessed the change that the Lord had made in his heart through his time with Jesus. He started to be more humble in that process. And now he's a spokesperson because he's seen it all. We too can learn from Peter a bit on being a spokesperson of what the Lord has done and is continuing to do in our own lives. Peter also acknowledges that he is a partaker of the glory that is going to be revealed. And he gets a glimpse of that as well. And that's in Luke 9 and 28. It says, now 8 days after these sayings, he took with them Peter. Jesus is the him here. He took with him Peter, John, and James, and they went up on the mountain to pray. This is known as the Mountain of Transfiguration, and we'll learn why it's called that here in a minute. It says, and he was praying, and his appearance on his face was altered. That is the transfiguration. And his clothing became dazzling white, further transfiguration. And behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who had gone to be with the Lord, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure. Peter got a glimpse of the glory. Later on in the text, a voice comes from heaven saying, from God saying, this is my son, listen to him. And of course, Peter is doing that. So suffering and glory are never far apart in Peter's mind. He's witnessed them both. And he now is encouraging the leaders to be humble in knowing that we serve a Lord that suffered, and we serve a Lord that is returning in all glory. But how does a leader lead humbly? Well, Peter shows that in verse 2. This is a summary statement here. He says, hey, man, just shepherd the flock of God among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly. Peter is addressing God's people as a flock, and a flock is 20 or more people. Peter is saying, whoever is leading this group of people should have certain characteristics. A shepherd carries out oversight, protecting and leading and encouraging and teaching, guiding and feeding. Being a shepherd is a calling, and it is a call for action. As in, do it now, do it effectively, oh, and yeah, do it humbly. This text here has a sense of urgency to it. And if you know Peter, that's just how he is. He's kind of like, he was like a pretty impatient guy, right? He's pretty aggressive too. And so here, he's demonstrating that in the text, same attitude, but for a different purpose. Shepherd the flock of sheep, as we are described as sheep. You guys know anything about sheep? I would encourage you to read up on sheep. It's no coincidence that we are described as sheep. Sheep are lost. They require constant oversight, constant leading, and constant cleaning. If they're not cleaned, they will die. If we're not cleaned, we will die. The second death. We are cleaned by the washing away of our sins, right? Through Jesus Christ. Thank God for that. As a shepherd goes, there goes the sheep. So if a shepherd is growing, the sheep are growing. If a shepherd is stagnant, the sheep will be stagnant. Peter is saying, be a shepherd and be a good one. Jesus is the ultimate example of a shepherd, right? He guides, he led, he fed, but he also laid down his life for us. He laid down his life for the flock. And it seems as though as Peter has taken on that role, that responsibility. In fact, it was transferred to him here in the text, not the text today, but in God's word. It's in John 21. So Jesus was crucified and risen, had appeared to the disciples a few times, and he appears to them again on the Sea of Galilee. And even though he had instructed the disciples to go, therefore, and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and I will be with you until the end of times, that is the Great Commission, he finds them fishing. And so what does he do? But cook them breakfast. And when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Love here is the Greek word agape. Agape love is the love that God can give, that God gives. Like, it's something that we could shoot for, but we'll never achieve agape love. But in this conversation, Jesus is saying, do you love me more than these? And these, he didn't say a specific thing. He didn't say, do you love me more than the fish that you're going for here? Do you love me more than the disciples or the boat? No, he says, do you love me more than these, which encompasses everything? He's saying, do you love me more than everything in your life? Are you willing to lay down everything for me like Jesus did? That's why he can only give agape love. And then Peter says, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to them, Jesus, then feed my lambs. He said to him a second time, Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know I love you. He said to him, then tend to my sheep, shepherd them. He said to him the third time, and now Simon is starting to get offended here. Says, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him a third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, then feed my sheep. The mantle has been passed on. And do you see the progression here? I really sense that Peter was delivered and set free from pride in this moment. Because you remember, he adamantly said that I would never fall away from you, Lord. I would never deny you. And he denies him three times. Not once, but three times. And then, of course, here, Jesus runs him through the gamut three times. And I'm thinking that Peter is reflecting on that time that he denied Jesus. And he's like, okay, I messed up that time, but I'm not going to allow that to happen again. And we see that in the text here. Peter is encouraging us to shepherd the flock, those leaders in the church. He says that we do it not under compulsion. In other words, a shepherd does it not because he's constrained or forced to do it. A leader should not occupy the office of leadership as a reluctant draftee or someone who is just like, man, I really don't want to do this. Why am I doing that? That's not the attitude of a leader. A leader does this willingly. And notice in the text, it says that he doesn't do it for shameful gain. Peter is not only talking about financial or material things here. He's also talking about shameful game of popularity, like doing what's popular in the culture so that you can grow the congregation of the church. You might add this thing to God's word, or you might take this thing away from God's word. A leader doesn't do that. A shepherd does not do that. A shepherd also does not lead in a way to where he is leading a certain group of people one way because they have financial means or they're wealthy than the ones who are less wealthy a different way. No, a shepherd does not do that. He doesn't do it for shameful gain. A shepherd must serve the Lord with a willing heart because he loves Jesus Christ and he loves the flock. In verse 3, Peter tells us, not in a domineering way to those who are under your charge, but being examples to the flock. A humble servant isn't heavy-handed or looking to dominate. Shepherds don't do that. Exerting a dominating attitude over someone or trying to combine your power to control someone is not the way that not only leaders should do that, but followers of Christ should not as well. And we're going to learn that later. And if you see that here, we want to know about it. If you see it in our leadership staff, we want to know. If you see it in our growth group leaders, we want to know. Because as a leader, there is high accountability. We as a staff, we have great accountability in public and in private. That includes our personal devices as well. So there's high accountability, but there are rewards. And we see that in verse 4. It says, and when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. And this crown is a description of what an athlete would be given at that time for the Greek games. If they threw a disc the furthest, or if they ran a race and they won, they would be given this crown of flowers. And the flowers were beautiful for about 3 days, and then they faded away. But Peter is telling us that we will receive a crown that's unfading. This crown is eternal, and it is beautiful for those who lead well all the way to the finish line. Leaders who faithfully endure the negative and the positive with humility in the manner described in verses 2-3 will be given this reward. The prospect of the future must have an impact on a leader's performance. And that future is that Jesus is coming. And he's coming with all power and all glory. His kingdom will come. So the difficulties of the work of a leader, the time put in, the long hours, the carrying the burdens of others, as well as our own inadequacies and our failures, could discourage the prudent. But when we turn our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, and focus on his return, it will cause the leader to persevere through every trial and every situation. All right, point two. And we see that in verse 5. And point two is a challenge for the young. Let's take a look at verse 5, the first half of verse 5. We'll call it 5A. It says, likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. And this context here is speaking to those who are newer to the faith. who are younger in spirit, and also it could be in age as well, be subject to the elders. And that's a picture of submission. God is a God of order, and he lays everything out for us in beautiful order. And so those who are new to the faith are should be subject to the elders, the more mature in the faith. We see that in our growth groups all the time. Our growth group leaders are more mature in the faith. At least we like them to be more mature in the faith, right? And growing in that. And as they grow, they then pour into the other group leaders, stirring them up, challenging them. Also, too, older men and women in the faith have a lot to pour into the younger generations when it comes to personal experiences as well. It's not only in God's word, of course, but there's things that older people have gone through that a young adult might be in the midst of right now. My wife and I count it a great joy to shepherd people through the seasons, the tough seasons that we've been through. And it's not ironic that the Lord will send you people that to do that with. But there's much to be gained from the mature. So Peter is calling for the younger to be subject to the elders. Again, this is a command to fall under the leadership that God has placed over you. I've always tried to have this going in my life, always someone older than me or someone more mature in God's word that I could sit with and meet with periodically for coffee and open up God's word. And then also someone younger than me that I am doing the same with. I would encourage you to do that as well. It's life-giving for you and the people that are mentoring you and then the people who are mentored by you. It's an encouragement. The third point is a call to everyone, all right? So if you're not a leader or a pastor or an elder and you turned your ears off in that first part, turn your ears back on right now because this is for you, all right? And it's in verse, we'll call it 5b, which is the second half of verse 5. It says, clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility towards one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. We're going to spend some time on this part because this is really important. The word clothed here comes from a Greek word, ikabonim, which comes from the root Greek word of ikabomai, which means to tie in a knot or to wrap around, gather together. And so it's interesting that Peter is using this word in the Greek that means tie in a knot. So it's a picture of a servant tying an apron around him in a knot to serve others. A servant who puts on an apron is ready to work for someone else. And they're expecting to get dirty. Peter is using this command and is calling for soldier-type obedience here. And should not be dismissed without significant consequences. Because pride stunts the spirit-fed stream of God's grace to us, which is necessary not just for salvation, but daily salvation. You know that thing called sanctification, right? We need a direct flowing stream of God's grace to us. And so Peter is saying, clothe yourself in humility. Like, tie it around you. We are servants in God's kingdom. We just don't come to observe. Okay, it's great that we come here. in the gathering to get encouragement through God's word and worship the Lord. That's great. But we should have our aprons on all the time, and we should be serving in humility. Peter's use of this Greek word, ikabomai, was reminiscent of a scene in John chapter 13. Let's take a look at that real quick. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going back to God. So Jesus knew, like, he's like, okay, I came to heaven. I know I'm going back. So I need to make sure that my humility's right and that I am serving. And that was Jesus' life. That's just what he did. But it's no coincidence that this statement was made here. He arose from supper and laid aside his outer garments, taking a towel. And look at what he does with the towel. He tied it, ikabomai, around his waist. And then he poured water into a basin. And he began to wash the disciples' feet and wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. That is a picture of being wrapped with humility. Ikabomai. Tie a knot in it. Jesus put on the clothes. He clothed himself with humility. And Jesus has given us an example of action. God gives grace to the humble, it says. And he opposes the proud. I love watching college football. I like pro football too, but only the Bears. But I love college football because these guys are trying to make it to the league, man. And, well, at least 10 years ago they were not getting paid. Now they're getting paid. But if you watch college football, you know about the Heisman Trophy, right? And the stance of the Heisman is this. It's a stiff arm. And stiff arms are more popular, I think, in the NFL. But a stiff arm is it's opposition. It's like, you're in the way. I'm going to stiff arm you so that you cannot get to me. When God opposes us, he's stiff arming us. You cannot get to him. And that's an awful position to be in. I would assume that someone who is prideful is not trying to get to him anyway, right? But we who need grace, which is all of us, we should not want to be opposed by God. Pride can keep those who are older from trying to understand who those who are younger are, who they are, and what they have to give, and the things that they have to say, the ideas and the good thoughts. I pastored our young adults for a season, and it was a fun time. And the cool thing about young adults is that they have a lot of new good ideas, and some of them are transitioning into like men's ministry now. And so we had our men's ministry night the other night, and so one of the young adults approaches me a few days before, and he wants to introduce some new technology. And I'm like, sure, let's do it. Let's give it a try. And it was a great success. But I would have never had the opportunity to witness what God was doing through that person if I opposed them, or if I'm like, you know what, I've been doing ministry long enough. I've been leading young adults. I've been doing all this. Bro, I got this. That's not humility. We are to listen to those who are younger, and the younger are to listen to those who are older. We all have ideas. God has made us all in a unique way. We all have gifts that are to be used to forward God's kingdom here on earth. So let's lead with humility. Pride can keep us stagnant. It can sneak up on us. it snuck up on Jesus through Peter, and he said, "Satan, get behind me." Some of the times we have to do that too. You know, we have to recognize where pride is in our lives, whether it's in the form of our work. Work can be prideful. I'm trying to achieve this certain position. I've achieved it. Great. I'm awesome. Pride could be in the salaries that we make. Could be in the neighborhood that we live in. Could be the car that we drive. It could be our approach, the clothing we wear, our tendency to manipulate people. But it's all unattractive. And God does not bless that. But he gives grace to the humble. And it's the grace that he gives us is the grace to endure. It is the grace to triumph over trials. It is the grace that when we are in the valley, we recognize that Jesus is there with us, fighting alongside of us. But sometimes pride can get us caught up in, "Lord, why did you allow this to happen?" Instead of, "Lord, you are with me, and I trust you, and I believe in that." Grace enables us to serve despite of difficulties. Whatever begins with God's grace will always end in his glory. I really love what Charles Spurgeon says on this subject of humility. He says that this verse exhorts believers to gladly accept the prone position. Now, those who are in the medical community, they know this term, the prone position. The prone position is this. The prone position is you on your face, on your belly, on the ground. And it's used for surgical procedures. Doctors will put you in the prone position as they begin to operate on you. Many of us need to take the prone position so that the Lord can operate on us and start to remove the pride in certain areas of our life, as he did with Peter. And Peter so clearly communicates to us. It is the call of every Christian to live out a humble life of servitude in the manner in which Jesus did it, wrapping ourselves in humility and ikabomai into a knot. I would assume that a knot is pretty hard to untie from the front, right? We need to wrap ourselves in humility, tie it in the knot, so it is not easily untied. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word and how it encourages us and how it demonstrates your will for our lives. It also gives us a glimpse of who you are. You came as a humble servant. You left heaven, the throne of heaven, and came and wrapped yourself, ikabomai, in humility. And so, God, it is our prayer that we can do the same. As we leave this building, may we exert humility in our posture, in the way that we treat our spouse, in the way that we lead our family and lead our children. Let others say, "Wow, there is something different about that person, and I want to know what it is." Lord, help us to represent you well in humility, and we promise to give you all of the glory and all of the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, it's always your kindness, Lord.
That's a great reminder of this powerful truth. Yes, yeah, we can clap. Our life is gonna be an offering this week. We begin that even right now, how we serve and come alongside each other. And the Lord looks at our hearts and how we engage with one another. May we have hearts of humility and looking to care and to serve one another. And that transfers over how we walk out of our four walls here into our neighborhoods, into our workplace. And people are watching the way that we live, if there's pride or if there's humility, if there's gentleness and respect. And so may, as we go out on mission today, a heart posture of gentleness and humility to draw people to Jesus with that bold proclamation of the gospel of Christ. And so that's what we get to do this week. A couple housekeeping things. Listen, if you're a part of High Five or you'd love to help us get ready for High Five, we've got a couple assignments. If you have a moment or so, we could use a bunch of guys to go behind that curtain and tear down some chairs to prepare that part of our worship center. And if you can stick around and help with some of the room setup, we've got an opportunity for you to meet Hannah Paternoster in Harvest Kids area. And she would love to utilize your time to set up for this week. We're praying that God does a great work. And if you're new to Harvest, I'd invite you to join me and Pastor Ramirez and Discover Harvest in the Hope Center. But as we go out on mission today and we live our offering before the Lord, know this, you are loved. Have a great day.